Thank you so much. I'm very happy to be invited here to speak at Berlin Buzzwords. Very thankful to the organizers and the volunteers. I have enjoyed almost all the sessions that I have been a part of. Today, I'm going to speak about the large-scale graph solutions, both the use cases and the lessons learned. Currently, I'm an engineer at Microsoft, working at the intersection of AI and cloud. Prior to that, I have been at Intuit in finance domain, and before that at Yahoo on big data, Hadoop computing from the very start. So this session today will take various turns, but when you speak about graphs at scale, anyone would have that bewildered look, because both of them, the topics are very, very complex, both the graph as well as at scale, right? And now you're trying to bring them together and think about graphs at scale. So it is a very important topic, but at the same time, it is complicated and challenging by itself as soon as you speak the two words together. So let us, before we get deep into it, let's take a step back and try to understand what we are talking about. Graphs was, it's actually very abstracted a term, a very powerful concept. It did not even start at this century. If you remember the Euler's path or Euler's tour, this was a concept that actually came in about 18th century. When the region of Persia, there was a land which had seven bridges. There was some island because of the water flowing in the land, and there were bridges on the land. So a person had asked whether you could traverse the bridges without crossing them again and traverse the whole path. Now, Euler actually confirmed that it is not possible to do this by a negative resolution, because the whole wonderful part about this is he was able to abstract the land and the bridges into node, the vertices and the edges. So the whole theory of the graph theory actually spawned from there, to be able to abstract that. And that has played such a powerful role in all the software development that has happened since then. So I really love it, and every now and then I'll go back to see how he actually did it, because the way the proof has been established is also very wonderful. But for our session today, all we can know is that graph is nothing but a function of a whole thing developed with vertices and edges. So vertices, some people call it nodes. Edges, some people call it relationships or connections. But in the end, the theory remains the same. Graph is nothing but a set of vertices and edges. But this is such a powerful thing in itself. And vertices is identified by something, and there could be multiple attributes to it. And edges also has a source and a destination, and there are multiple attributes to it. And that's about it, right? But if you think about the world that we are living in, we are all nodes, we are all vertices, and everything that we do brings in lot of edges, lot of relationship, lot of networks, right? Whether, and we'll talk about it later. But in brief, I also want to touch about, since it is a GDPR time that we are living in and privacy, you don't have to necessarily have the nodes with the name, the email, or the addresses. It is purely anonymized node, which has some features to it. And then also you can imagine a graph and how all the technology is built upon it. So this is in brief. There are different kind of attributes. There will be weights on the edges. There will be different features on the node, whether it is age, whether it is what domain that you work in, whether you're a doctor or an engineer. So it will be very different things, right? As you think about different domains. Degrees is how many nodes go in and out. So there's an in degree and an out degree to every node. So if you think this is a brief thing, so every, now the whole concept of graph can be summed into this whole two lines, right? G, V, E, and then the whole attributes. So this is a whole distilled idea of graph. But now there are so many graph algorithms that there's so many of them. And it is the most core part of anything that we do. One of the most famous ones, shortest path. We try to find out in quickly what is the path, how I can lead to this end result in the shortest manner. Breadth first search, and you have connected components. You go as far as possible to get all the child. You have a connected components. You have a depth first search, right? nearness, similarity, they play a very important role, whether it is string comparison, or if you are on Twitter, or Facebook, or any economy graph, you are actually connected by some attributes. We have some community kind of thing happening. So their connected components plays a very important role in further developing, enhancing your software, your tool. But in brief, these are the things that are always there, and you can imagine of different graphs of this kind, right? In fact, there's nothing in software that is not graph. And some of the very casual questions that happen, right? What are the other places like Berlin with the museums, or can you recommend some community that I can be a part of depending on the life patterns, or the books that people have read based on what I have also read, the kind of similarity, who can help me save money, and if they have faced similar financial situations like me. So you see that everything, right? Everything, whether it's healthcare, domain, anything, you see that the similarity, connections, the graph plays an important role. So we touched upon graph algorithms briefly, and we now to understand that graphs is the intelligence of the system. So anything that you visualize, you have data coming in, you have everything coming in, but unless you can have a graph, you cannot really build that intelligence. So in any company that I have worked in, there has been a lot of experimentation, a lot of things that we have done to build the graph, right? Whether it is knowledge graph, recommendation, personalization engine, or the fraud detection, it is some of the things that we help save customer the money, right, to avoid the issue happening. And this is enabled by a lot of things that are happening in the background, whether it is in the travel industry, giving advices, financial advices, healthcare, everything happens with this. This is just Silicon Valley is a very famous serial there, where we talk about something on technology, but in a funny way. So it gives you insight, but one of the most important thing that I would like to outline is graph and data science and AI kind of very tied together. And now you see that the AI is coming up, rising again. It's second term now, and it's rising again, but the powerful thing, it is the graph. The thing that we realized, as I mentioned, that I'm working intersection between data science and cloud, and there are a lot of things that happen at Microsoft. It is one of the largest AI research group that I have ever seen. We do a lot of things in healthcare, on voice recognition, there are a lot of things that happen, there are billions of things. But my knowledge right now is limited, but still, there are a lot of models that are being developed. As you develop it, you realize that do we reinvent the wheel again and again? Do we try to infer that knowledge that should have been there in the data in first place? So there is a growing consciousness in the technology people whether that information should have been in the data at the first place to help make the model part easier, right? And to go to the next step, rather than doing the same thing, inferring, right? So there's a growing need that data is more powerful and has some inferences by itself, whether it is internet data, incomplete data, how can the system infer in the first place, whether claimed, verified, observed, derived. These are the different kind of to get the data in a state where models can be more strongly built. So this is the one more reason that graphs has become once more very, very powerful, though it has been powerful in the last whole century. We have been doing a lot of this, but it is very important. Now I told you about graphs at scale, right? And at scale, many of the companies that I have worked with, the scale is one of the primary things. There are millions of customers, billions of data. The traffic is very, very huge, right? So, and you have trillions of data, how to manage it. And like I mentioned, there's incomplete data sometimes the data is incorrect. How to not have that cause issues, but to actually surpass that at first place, to plan for it, and then how to do that, right? So all this, when you talk about scale, you're actually thinking about all these layers. System capability, definitely, right? You have to think about storage, sharding, how the nodes are interacting with each other, what is the data transfer, how is it in memory. In memory is also a recent advancement, but it is important. And how much data is important? How much should you retain? Sometimes the data loses value. Near data is more important than the historic data. But in some cases, historic data is as equally important. Automation. So all these things come into play. And one of the things that in earlier sessions, we talked about Prometheus, all the different kind of monitoring. We also used Prometheus earlier in one of the sessions. The reason being, it gives you 99.999 kind of thing, right? Most of the monitoring tools limit to 99.9, and that is still a problem for large companies when they're talking about scale. The visibility, transparency should be to the higher level, right? So all these concepts, when you're talking about graphs or any other thing, you're talking about this all thing together. So the scale is such an overloaded concept, because as soon as you talk about scale, you are thinking of everything, right? Security, it is all encrypted, decrypted. So your data is actually encrypted, decrypted as well. So that will have a latency. You have to have keys that are rotating, and the rotation should be baked in. And rawness is very important when the data is there, how you're classifying, you are controlling, and the lineage of it, right? Ease of use is very important. No matter whatever wonderful things that you're developing, if it is not easy to use, no user is going to use it. No customer is going to use it, right? So all these things are very important. And they are this. Some of the things are not even possible right now, what I'm stating. But as soon as you're saying that you have to do the query, update, remove, how can it happen? And how is it happening today? So we'll talk about that. So briefly now, we have come to understand what is graph, how important it is, what are graph algorithms, what does it mean to scale. So let us touch upon what kind of graph we are already seeing. And at least I have worked on all of these, but there are many others that I have cursorily looked into. Among them was RangoDB, which I looked into only few days or so. But it's one of the nice graph from Dishlang itself. There was OrientDB, however, I never had a chance to look into that. So these are some of the primary graph style that you will observe. The graph database, Neo4j, is one of the very, very prominent database that I had been using since a very early time. It has, in fact, maintained its different features. It has done a lot of feature development. It is a proprietary version which has much more than the free versions. So you have to pay some money for it if you want the whole set of features available. But it is one of the good ones. And even NASA uses it to have some knowledge graph, and it saved some money because it was able to develop something and got the visibility on what metrics were there and was able to prevent an error in some of the flights. I do not know exact details, but that is powered by Neo4j. And it is really one of the good databases. MarkLogic database, I had the occasion to use it because the ontology, like I was trying to the inference of the data, how to infer it on the runtime, how to infer the relationship, or how to correct the incorrectness of the data, or how to have the incomplete data, how to make the derived data on the fly, right? So I tried to use that 9.0 version of it on the cloud, and then there's a proprietary version as well, which does something different. There's another one that is data stat graph by Cassandra Dozdries. And we used it in one of the earlier times when we had a lot of things running on Cassandra, and that really helps when you lot of stuff is running on Cassandra, and you can actually use other modules of it as well. However, at that time, DataStat was actually in process of acquiring Titan, so there was a little bit fuzzy, so that experimentation did not actually succeed to the level that we wanted, but it has some of the capability that we needed. It is also developing more. DGraph is something that only recently heard. It is a database system, again, we're developing Go. So Go is another powerful language that people are developing because of the performance versus Java and C++. So that is also worth a look. But in brief, it is a graph database that you get online transaction processing. So it is happening on the fly. You are doing some transaction. It is getting saved in a graph database. So when you query, you will have easy retrieval of data. That is the goal that you're trying to look into, rather than using the RDBMS. But at the same time, there's graph pipelines. Because the world that we live in, the data is coming from all places, every side and corner. So you have huge data, like clickstream, lot of data of this style, right? Which is the raw data is so huge. It is like billions and trillions of records per second kind of thing. So you have to develop pipelines kind of thing, where streaming, you have Kafka, you have Spark, you have different processing that is happening. Spark GraphX was one of the things that we were trying. However, it lost momentum because it was done by some person who was not full-time working with Databricks, but it has now gotten another developer who has actually developed the draft frames built upon data frames, which is faster as well. And it is actually a wrapper around the GraphX, and it is faster. So it has its own API. Flink draft is worth a mention because when we were doing some experimentation with Flink versus Path, we found some cases the Flink is faster. However, the adoption of Spark is more in all the industry, in all the domains. But it is something that, like I said, the draft is not a thing that is complete. It has been going on for centuries, but there's a lot to be done still. Because like I mentioned, it is the intelligence. Intelligence is never static, right? It develops to become better and better. So that is the thing. And you have Draft Cloud, Microsoft Azure, Cosmos database does all the things that you mentioned here, but it also gives you the fault tolerance and all the things that you need in a cloud interface. There are other cloud providers as well. So they also have some GA mechanism where they try to develop the draft database on cloud. But now let's take to slice them one by one, right? Like I mentioned, this two lines actually summarizes everything that you want to understand about graph in one shot, right? But there's a lot to it, right? Like I said, we are not going to use RDBMS any longer. Because when I say, hey, tell me everything about you and connect it to you, right? It takes a lot of time in a relational database because you have to actually join another table, then you go to another table, club it together. The whole mechanism, the performance is really unachievable. If you want to have a real-time system, right, which people are going to use, you cannot do such a thing where you're joining the thing, right? So RDBMS no longer works, right? So that is the reason that draft database which stores the data in a different fashion, in which you actually don't do the traversal and join and do the traversal. You actually have the data stored in a way where you can quickly retrieve, and that is a key point that you want to have a natural way of retrieving data, because it seems really forced when you are doing from one table to another. But that was a whole normalization, ER modeling, and everything that we have been doing, which caused the RDBMS as a single thing, right? But there's also multi-model draft database, which means that it actually can use all the other databases, but it can interface with each one of them and create you a draft view, right? And there are many other systems which are multi-model. OrientDB is one of them, but Cosmos Azure is definitely. But OrientDB I have never tried, actually. Asset is another thing, because whenever you're talking about something like this, are you saying that you can comply with asset, atomic, consistent, isolated, durable? Because it's really a tough challenge, right? Even when people say it is durable and everything is consistent, there's always a time lag. So you have to take your thing, how much of time lag is OK with you. Draft database are OK with medium to large data. So like we said, we have three different options. And draft databases work for if you have small data. But there are proprietary solutions on the draft database, which work on the larger ones as well. But I wasn't doing the proprietary version so much. It's still debatable, but I haven't tried. So if anybody else has done. So this all builds upon also the expressive draft queries, right? There are different ones. Gremlin was one of the first ones, Cypher and Spark SQL. But there's also an open Cypher thing, which I did not mention here maybe. But there's an open spec. So people are trying to come together on what is a draft language, because anytime you evaluate something else, you have to learn something different, right? That really takes a toll or wastes some time, and we are trying to aggregate and align to one direction. And there's a lot of pattern matching that you can do, group by attribute, and find the thing, the data with the query. So these are the sample. It might not be important for you to remember. Even I do not remember this. I always have to see what is the syntax here right now and find out the matching, get the answer. But it is very, very simple. Once we do 2, 3, you get the data as you want, right? And this is a field which is growing. Many proprietary tools have their own kind of language. However, I do not think that is going to sustain, because in the long term, people need to align to some open standards. When you start seeing open standards coming, which means it's really important and we need to align somehow to. And this is, again, what I mentioned. This is a proprietary Neo4j capabilities. If you can pay money, then you can get all of this together. MART logic is something that harmonization and input flows, but you actually have to define something in advance. To get the ontology defined, it has a triple set, and you do the smart QL queries to get the data. So there's a lot of reasoners that you can develop. There are Python reasoners, Python OWL1, OWL2. There are different features and parity differences between them. And it is it's a developing field. How to do the harmonization correctly to get the inferences in the data itself while the data is flowing. But I did see you did graphs at scale, right? But this still seemed like something that is you're doing with medium to large data. Really, this is how things are happening in graph? It's not believable, because this is now not even data. As we go into any data conference, we are listening about streaming. We are listening that the data is coming in such a huge quantity. Are we doing it this way? Really not. This is a brief representation. It is not completely, it's very simplified kind of view, where you see graph pipelines that we are developing in each organization are fairly similar, and in a sense, kind of this, right? Where you have continuous stream of data coming in. And there's a messaging layer. Kafka now can do K-stream, K-SQL, lot of things. But definitely, the messaging layer is the most reliable. Kafka is the most reliable on that. You can do partitioning, and there are a lot of things that you can do there. And it is a where the data is coming reliably in no duplicates that you can handle, and it comes into a cloud kind of thing. It can be any cloud. It can be your private cloud, it can be a hybrid cloud, or it can be entirely an Azure network. So inside that, you're doing a lot of filtering, transforming, you are doing some ML. You have also the Spark draft frames, right, which is a recent 2 years kind of thing where it has developed, but there's still some development that is going on. You can do some draft, and it is API is very, very simple. You have just, you create the data frame, you do the same thing, you get the vertices, you define the vertices, which has this many attribute, you get them, and you can have edges, which has this many attribute, and they are connected by A, E. So in the edges, you just define the source and destination and whatever attributes, right, on the edge. It can have weight, or it can be prominent, or it can be partner, it can be vendor, kind of. So it will be depending on the domain, how you define it, and then you can have the same functionality, whether you can do what all you can do with the drafts, right? How you can group by something, some attribute, and then you can filter by something greater than something. So you can quickly find that out, right? API gives you that the abstraction layer so that everything is hidden, but that helps a lot to the developer community. Similarly, the Flint Jelly, which has similar capabilities built on data set, and it is also worth looking. It is also developing in a fast pace. And it has the same API, all the APIs, couple of lines APIs that you can develop the thing. So here, you can also store everything. Now there's a line coming to the draft database, right? So nothing actually is working in isolation. Since the raw data is really very, very huge, and you're doing a lot of processing, you get that data. Sometimes people also push that data to draft DB, because now it is aggregated, and you get some view, and you're pushing that relationship into a draft DB for easy consumption for user interface, right? And you might have even more condensed view in the application database, because application database, if it is a production facing, then you don't want to change it so change the state so often. So you will depend how you want to optimize the push of the state, right? So there's a lot of things that are happening here, and they are happening together. Sometimes a single solution is not working in isolation. They are working together to achieve something. But we realize that there's data that is flowing, and really this is how it is happening. Even the Elasticsearch we used in some cases for the test search for the Solar based on Solar and Lucene indices. So you have basically all these things happening, and which are very easily usable. They sound very complex at first, but if you try one sample thing, it is very, very easily usable. They have Java, Scala, Stala, Python APIs, so it has a large developer base who can use it easily. Draft Cloud is one of the things where you want to sync it and distribute it, file tolerance, and get it on the cloud itself, right? People 86% of the Fortune 500 or Microsoft Cloud, the enterprise thing, right? So that functionality also needed to be there. So Microsoft has actually managed to do this Azure Cosmos DB. I only recently joined Microsoft and I used it recently. I was able to do it in half a day to get that graph working, get all the data, and see the vertices, edges. So it's very, very simple for an enterprise customer who are already using it to actually start using their data from their network into the system, do APIs, and use it. So I believe, and that would be the case for any other cloud provider who's trying to provide a graph service. However, now we jump to nearing the end of the thing, right? Like I mentioned, this particular aspect of the software development or the technology, right? It is very, very engaging, and I have been involved into it in multiple different fashions, in different projects, because once you realize it is actually, once you handle the data correctly or model the data correctly, the intelligence somewhere resides there. So you can have every kind of thing, every kind of functionality you can develop if you correctly understand it and have the intelligence directly captured there. So it is still not a done thing, right? Because as I understand, every day I see something new, try something new, and there are a lot of experimentations that are being done. At an organization level, sometimes it depends what is the customer needs, and sometimes one solution serves for you, sometimes an array of solutions that you're working together to get it working for you. So it is the customer, it is the ease of use, who is providing the APIs which are very easily usable, connectable to your rest of the system, rest of your application. There's something that the customer needs to call to retrieve the graph. So how can we provide that, right? And there are challenges here, because updating the graph is a concept itself is so challenging. Because if you imagine there's so much data and you're trying to update it, it means that all the nodes and vertices, that edges, whatever is updating, you have to update that. You have to retrieve the right node, you have to update that. It has some performance impact, right? So how are you going to do it? Besides that, the API right now are not doing the update real time. You actually recreate the graph. You are not actually updating, inserting, and updating. You are actually recreating the graph, which has some cost. So all the create, read, update, delete functions are not very much optimized right now. You can do it, but you have some impact. You have some time. You have to optimize how you are going to use it, how much in the background you are going to do, what kind of staleness of the data would be there, what is in the cache. All that has to be taken care right now. This is still happening, and we will see something more in 5 years or so. Graph visualization, you see a lot, like I saw provided you in Azure Cosmos. There are many other, even in Mark Logic, I had done something. I did not paste that view, but you can quickly get that view. As you harmonize the data, you see all the graphs building, you can see the tradition. Even in the Elasticsearch, when we did, we were pushing the data, and we were able to see the graph quickly with Kibana and stuff, right? So there's a lot of things that to be done, and let 1,000 flowers bloom, right? But then, because like you saw, there are a lot of options that are available, a lot of things that you can try. Some things are more conducive to your org per se, but sometimes you have to, because an organization needs to, is a business also, right? So you have to cut down on some experiments and get the right experiment moving. So you. Ideally, any organization would like not to have too many ad hoc ETL processes, because if you have a single data model that can do that, that is like a holy grail. That is all that we are trying to do that. But in a business, really, it's not really possible. Because in a big org, you will have so many modules and so many different databases, so many different formats. To bring it together, it's not really, it's OK in theory, but theory and practice are different, because they are same in theory, but they're different in practice, right? So it has a lot of challenges around there. Even when you're moving the data, there is a challenge. And if there's historical data, there are different set of challenges. You have a syncing between the analytics and the end user platform, which because you don't want to impact the end user customer, and the analytics will be doing a lot of changes, right? So in conclusion, once does not simply be done with graphs, because it's an ongoing field. And it's very, very interesting, and it's one of the very core field in which there's a lot of potential to go ahead. So that would be my time. Thank you so much for listening. This is the last session of the day. I can't believe I got the whole audience. Thank you so much. Thank you.